Start.
Apaji, your hospital name, can you just tell me?
Sir, we are live now. You can start.
Sims Hospital.
Sims. Good afternoon, everyone. Good evening, everyone. This is Dr. Shailesh Adgaonkar from Pune. Today, we welcome you all for the second season of Spine Connect virtual webinar series. And in today's webinar series, we will be discussing about dilemmas in spine surgery, the common problems which all orthopedic surgeons face, the fellows face in teaching. Also, we have always confusion about disc fused versus discectomy, high grade listhesis, whether to do open versus MIS, and all these things we will demystify. Today, I welcome you on behalf of Pune Orthopedic Society, Dr. Narayan Karne, who is the president, who has given us wholehearted support for this webinar, and Sanchiti Hospital for supporting us for this. At the same time, I would like to thank Ortho TV, Dr. Ashok Sham, and the team for giving us great support. I welcome you all today for this, and we have stalwarts in spine surgery. And we have none other than Dr. Shankar Acharya. Dr. Acharya sir is the president of Association of Spine Surgeons of India and is presently working at Sant Gangaram Hospital, Delhi, as the chairman of Department of Orthopedic and Spine Surgery. We have the faculty from Mumbai, Dr. Mihir Bapat, who will be starting the show as an opening batsman, and he'll be talking about at 15-20 years of experience, he is still confused in dealing with these issues which come across in our practice. And Dr. Mihir is a director of spine surgery at Nanavati Super Speciality Hospital with a vast experience of around 20 years plus. And we'll be happy to see what why he's confused today. We welcome you, Mihir.
Thank you.
We have Dr. Appaji Krishnan from Sims Hospital, one of the faculty, one of the authority in most of the Indian and international meetings from Chennai. And Appaji is known for his academic brilliance. At the same time, his Herculean difficult surgeries, what he performs. We welcome Dr. Appaji for today's webinar. We have Dr. Pradyuman Pairaiturkar, who will be dealing with the lumbar disc. Is a maestro and he is a national international level authority in microscopic microendoscopic surgeries, and Dr. Pradyuman will be enlightening us about why he prefers to do a decompression discectomy for a large L4-5 disc. Dr. Pradyuman is working at Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, Pune, as a consultant spine surgeon. We have Dr. Guru Raj, who is again a nationally accredited superstar from Delhi, and who will be discussing in the debate today with us for fusion. And Dr. Guru Raj, as we all know, he's a great academician known for his robotic skills and great Herculean surgeries. We welcome Dr. Guru Raj for today's webinar. We would like to thank all of the star faculties for today's symposium, and we have the master who will be clearing our confusion, Dr. Himanshu Kulkarni, one of the youngest spine surgeon practicing at Sangli and Kolhapur belt in Maharashtra. And he has done extremely great work in academics, research, and he's doing very good practice in this belt. He'll be demystifying with literature and evidence support for disc fusion, MIS, and high-grade listhesis. So we welcome you, Dr. Himanshu, for today's webinar. And I would like to ask Dr. Shankar Acharya to say a few words before we start today's webinar.
Good evening, Shailesh. Thank you for inviting me to this debate and demystifying all the confusions in spine surgery. As we all know, spine surgery is always a challenge. So all the people who do spine surgery are special in a way in my mind, because when I used to train for hip and knee replacements, there were less challenges those days, and I got bored with hip and knee replacements. So I switched over to spine surgery. And spine surgery, every case is different. Every result is different. Every outcome is different. and learning what to do when in which patient is probably the most important challenge. So learning when to not to operate rather than the procedure is probably our biggest challenge. So we will see what Mihir has to say with cases. So even a simple case like a disc prolapse may have different outcomes and different problems, and somehow a easiest surgery of a discectomy may turn out to be a nightmare sometimes, and sometimes the results are fantastic in these. So we can start. I welcome all the faculty and the delegates. I can see all of them full of energy, and Shailesh is there raring to go. And thank you, Shailesh, for inviting. And thank you, Dr. Shyam, for helping spine and orthopedics in taking this first education to a grassroots level all over the country and the world. Thank you,
Mr. President, ASSI, Dr. Shankaracharya. I would like to invite Dr. Narayan J. Karne, the president of Pune Orthopedic Society, to say a few words. Over to you, Karne, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shailesh. On behalf of Pune Orthopedic Society, I welcome all for the Spine Connect Spine Webinar Series 2, which is run under the aegis of the Pune Orthopedic Society as well as Sancheti Hospital, Pune. There are certain areas in the spine which are always which put the surgeons in dilemma. And two main important out of these is the large disc, and the second is the higher grade listhesis, whether one should go for open or miss for listhesis. And to clear our all these, Dr. Shailesh Hadgaonkar has arranged a wonderful seminar and debate, and we have got a who's who in the field of spine today. I welcome President of the Association of Spine Surgeons of India, Dr. Shankar Acharya, as well as the faculties and the stalwarts from all over India, right from the Masters in Mumbai, Dr. Mihir Bapat and Dr. Arvind Kulkarni, and from Chennai, Dr. Appaji Krishnan, and from our own Pune, Dr. Pradyumna Pai Raiturkar, as well as the budding and rapidly, you can say, progressive young orthopedic surgeon from Sangli Miraj, Dr. Himanshu Kulkarni. I also thank Dr. Ashok Shyam for providing this platform of the Ortho TV. Now it has become the, I will say, one of the largest platform, or the platform which gives at least some 7 or 8 webinars per day consistently for more than 1.5 years now. We have to really appreciate him for that. And one more faculty, Dr. Gururaj from Delhi. So I thank Dr. Shailesh for arranging this webinar and giving the academic face to the not only the spine surgeon, for a general orthopedic surgeon like us also who do occasional spine. Thank you, Dr. Shailesh.
Thank you, sir, for your great support and Pune Orthopedic Society. On behalf of all the team members, I thank everyone for this great opportunity for the academic platform. We will start with our webinar, the Spine Connect, and I would request Dr. Mihir Bapat to start with his confusion. Over to you, Mihir, sir.
Thank you, Shailesh, for having me here. Thank you for all the esteemed faculty to share my confusions here. Are you guys seeing me now?
Yes.
Okay. So I think all of us must agree that degenerative disorders are like they are eternal infinite teachers. And we are like backbenchers just waiting to commit the next mistake where they catch us. And this is where we are confused. Now, look at all these examples and tell me you're not. A 72-year-old young elderly, very, very active, used to walk about 10K. He was conserved for his pain, though he had a leg pain of 8 out of 10. The surgeon really did very well and started off with an endoscopic discectomy. Now, I as a surgeon have this tremendous craving for learning endoscopic discectomy till now. So the patient underwent an endoscopic discectomy, had significant pain after 4 weeks of discectomy. After that, he had an SI joint block, a greater trochanter block, 2 epidural injections, luckily no neurology. And this was the MRI 4 weeks after the endoscopic discectomy. So the first MRI went along with the scar, because the scar had disappeared, but this was the next MRI. So it showed a large recurrent disc with evidence of modic changes, or bone marrow edema, as we call it. So this patient was not walking at all. He was conserved for about 1.5 years post-surgery, and these were his x-rays, no instability at all. So I would agree that probably a microscopic discectomy or an endoscopic discectomy is the correct procedure of choice. And we completed the endoscopic discectomy, hoping that that would be the end of his problems. So I started re-believing on on microscopic discectomy after this, till this 23-year-old air hostess came to me. Air hostess, athletes, and all these people have to be conserved. They have to be kept away from fusions because it is like a job-changing procedure for them. You cannot put implants into them. So this patient was severely painful. This was the disc. And as you can see, there was a degenerative disc below it. So naturally, a microscopic discectomy became the first procedure of choice. So we offered the patient a discectomy. And after 3 years, this patient landed up with a recurrence of the disc at the same level and also increase in the protrusion at the next level. So we subjected the patient to the inevitable fusion that a 23-year-old patient had to undergo. So necessarily, it would mean a job change. A young patient with a fusion, you have subjected this patient to one more surgery or two more surgeries in a lifetime. Should I have opted for a microscopic decompression again? After 3 years with such large discs at two levels, I have no answer for that. Does one procedure score over the other? We often have debates that microscopy is better than endoscopy, is better than transforaminal endoscopy, and all these discussions. Or it is just that we are just satisfying our ego by saying that one procedure is better over the other. So these two examples have raised these two questions for me. I hope our esteemed faculty can answer this for me. Now, this is a 57-year-old captain of a ship. Okay, he had an old surgery, which was about 8 years back. He had a fusion. And this was the lower end of the MRI. Here is the fusion. And he had a skip normal level. And he developed a disc one level above that. So naturally, one would want to do a microscopic discectomy. And that is what we did. So this patient was all right. And after a year, he came with a recurrence on the opposite side. So first he had a disc on the left, and then he came with a recurrence of the disc on the right. Now what do you do? So do you do a microscopic discectomy again? This patient wanted a fusion because he had behaved very, very well after a fusion. And I did not want to do a fusion because that would mean that you would leave a skip in between. And this patient underwent a fusion. So this was the x-ray. So a funny looking x-ray, a good looking patient with a normal disc in between now. Will this patient remain normal for a long time? Can anyone answer this question for me? I hope the esteemed faculty can slug it out later. So what were the options available to this patient? Finally, he was a captain. You want him to keep working. So do we have answers for this? Now, this is a 72-year-old retired person, sedentary lifestyle. L5-S1 disc is settled. And L4-5 fusion was done with a bone graft about 8 years back. Okay, I agree that, you know, the L4 to S1 lordosis is a little less. And that is why after 8 years, he developed an adjacent segment disease. Is that even true? If it is true, then he should have developed an adjacent segment within the first 2 years. But he developed an adjacent segment after 8 years. Now, does that mean that the first fusion was bad? And what would you do? So we opted to remove the previous implants and we fused it. But the question still remain answered. Does any type of surgery really delay adjacent segment? Do measurements of lumbar lordosis L4 to S1, can we really achieve that on table the way we want it preoperatively? Does that really impact the incidence of adjacent segment? Is it conclusively proven? And really, don't talk about OLIFs as a solution to everything. Please, that doesn't work here. So now this is a 45, this is a common scenario now. You have young osteoporotics. So you tend to have large discs, you tend to fuse them. a beautifully placed cage and a jerk and the cage sank. Now, who's to blame? So conveniently, we blame the biology because the patient is not too symptomatic and you have gotten away with the result. So you tend to blame the biology, and the wonder drug is the teriparatide, as if teriparatide is going to solve all your problems in life. So really, is PEEK the solution? Is teriparatide the solution? And please do not say OLIF again. Thank you very much. So the next problem is this. Now, this is a 62-year-old doctor. Look at this cage. This doctor came 1.5 years after surgery, totally asymptomatic. But the cage was undersized. It was a 10 millimeter cage which had backed out. And luckily for the surgeon, this patient was asymptomatic. If you see the big hole there, this is what our cage introducers tend to do. You know, they are big. And when you hammer the cage in, you often punch a hole in the end plate. And that hole itself provides a tract for the cage to back out. So, you know, you have problems of the implants, you have problems of the instrumentation, cheaper instrumentation, undersized cages. Really, is this surgery wrong to do in the first place? Now, now let us move to the burning topic, high-grade listhesis, whether to reduce or not to reduce. I love to reduce. I am a surgeon. I restore anatomy. That is my ego. So we have slowly moved towards an MIS kind of, we do an hybrid kind of fixations. So really hybrid or MIS means navigation, means neuromonitoring, means robotics, means high resolution C-arms, which specialized instruments, higher experience in MIS. Now this makes the surgery only in the hands of the few. Everyone cannot do it. So is that the goal of a surgery, that you restrict the number of people who are doing these surgeries, or you want to have a technique which can be used by all? Okay, now these problems are unanswered. I'm sure our colleagues would answer that. So this is my own case, which was done about 13, 14 years back. Less experience, open technique, struggle inside, trying to find the entry points of a deep-seated pedicle, could not capture one pedicle, extending it to the other. So all this, finally, you have all these problems of bleeding, implant malposition, neural injuries, infections, loss of corrections. But luckily, this patient has done well. So I want all these answers to be given today. Otherwise, I'm going to personally take it out on all of you, Shailesh. So, khuda meherban to gadha pehlwan. This we all know. But pehlwan jo khud ko khuda samjhe, wo gadho ka pehlwan. So, I hope you can answer all these queries for me, because I am still a very small, confused person. Thank you.
Very well demonstrated, Mir, and all the cases were excellent, and I am really puzzled. I really don't know the answer. I feel sometimes, you know, if the patient comes, simple discectomy, do it and get away. But that patient comes back after 2-3 months and again there is a disc. We don't know the answer for this. I think we have the guys today, Dr. Arvind, Dr. Pradyuman, Dr. Gururaj, Dr. Appaji will demystify on this. But I would like to ask our own president, Dr. Shankaracharya, about any interesting scenarios in his practice. Because in Delhi, you know, sabse important kya hai ki tujhe pata hai main kaun hu. So they call a lot of high profile people, politicians, and you know, people call. So some interesting something which we would like to know from Shankar sir.
Thanks, Alice. But I think for us, every patient is a patient, number one. Second, whatever Mihir has shown, the variety is fantastic. I think we should focus on these five disc cases and the listhesis itself. One thing is for sure, as surgeons, we know one prescription doesn't fit all. And so there is not a single solution to one prescription. However, Mihir did say whether transfer. Let me just quickly say whatever I remember of the cases that he showed. The first case he showed was a transforaminal discectomy, which went wrong, and that was an L5-S1. I think in the right hands, it has a role, and especially people who are doing a good job of it and are able to do extra foraminal discectomies or posterolateral discectomies, which are not hard well, and so that it works well. I have seen quite good results. However, the first important, as a, since Dr. Karne is there and general orthopedic surgeons are also listening, even if you go minimally invasive, we have to be safe. Do no harm remains with all orthopedic surgeons. So what Mihir showed, that big list of expensive things that he has, that Nanavati, everybody doesn't have. So he has to do accordingly. So you have to be safe. If you don't have navigated pedicle screw system, then you will have to put in open. But obviously access related problems is the biggest challenge in which we are discussing about minimal invasive, open or mini open. So the access related tissue damage and the access related morbidity is the main thing which we are now trying to minimize by doing more minimally invasive. However, I think the most important thing is decision making. The first case where he did a transforaminal discectomy and then converted to mini microscopic discectomy is perfect. I think I would do the same. The second air hostess in which he did a discectomy followed by a fusion, I would do a repeat discectomy, because till the third recurrence, I do discectomies. And sometimes a lot of patients who are, as Shailesh said, VIP, they go here and there, they say they should have done fusion. So there is a debate, as you know, a lot of surgeons do primary fusion in a large lumbar disc and they justify it. However, in my practice, I normally never do a primary lumbar fusion in a large lumbar disc. I always conserve. And so fusion is a salvage procedure. Unless we have a fusion for hip, fusion for knee is a salvage procedure. So similarly, fusion for spine is a salvage procedure. It alters the biomechanics of the spine for all. And adjacent segment degeneration is bound to happen along with the normal degeneration. So it accelerates it. And I think we have seen it in cervical spine, you've seen it in lumbar spine. So these things are there. I think we can discuss each case. Mihir quickly went through all and then said, that Kashmiri statement, Allah Meherban to Gada Pehlwan. So I think we are all Pehlwan because Allah is Meherban to all of us, certainly. But The second statement is not true, because koi bhi, at the heart of our heart, we know that a spine surgeon is never flying in the air, unlike a lot of other types of surgeons, because each spine surgeon has his complication and he falls flat on the earth. And I've had my many complications. At least the moment I think I've done a great surgery, in a month or two later, I'll have some major complication. I fall flat on the earth and then I can't sleep all night. So that is good. He's raised the debate in a filmy style. So let's discuss. And
I wanted to ask is that like why I said high profile, or sometimes, you know, if the case is done by you yourself, and the patient comes back with a recurrence, then you have a, you know, in general, we have seen that you feel like doing again, now it's my patient, I know what we have done and it's a recurrent disc, I will decompress. But when the patient is operated by some other surgeon, we feel whether it is recurrent, whether it is residual, all these things are there, so better to fix it. This mindset is there in a lot of surgeons.
Yes. That will remain, I suppose. If you have an infection, you will always tend to think that it is not infection and is superficial serous discharge. So that has to change with training and humility. So as soon as you have a high CRP and a little discharge, I open up and I tell them, wash out and wash out is probably the most important. You must accept it. You must ensure in your practice that all your complications come back to you and they stay with you. Only if your complications come back to you and stay with you, I think it is more important that then you have succeeded in getting the confidence of that patient. So I take it very seriously when my recurrence comes, and I still counsel them and discuss with them. Obviously, I spend more time discussing with them about the options of fusion versus non-fusion. And I still remember a patient, I did recurrent discectomy 3 times. His name was Manoj, and he worked in leather industry. And finally, I fused him at the age of 26. So after 3 discectomies. So you can understand. So these things will always come in spine. You can never say.
Perfect. I would like to ask one more important question. How much percent of time, how much percentage wise, when the patient asks, sir, aap guarantee loge kya? Will you take 100% guarantee? Or how much percent you say this is the in my hands, I will give, this is a good chance you will not have recurrence. So what is the percentage in your practice you tell to your patients?
About discectomy, about fusion.
Yeah, discectomy and fusion, both.
So in discectomy, I never take guarantee. I have reached the stage in life when people would come normally and then said, sir, surgery karana hai, to date lena hai, to types na. So I am very careful about this, because as you grow older, you know that if you take guarantee, you are calling for trouble. And the patient expects that even his toothache would be solved after the spine surgery. So you don't take guarantees. You say that there is a recurrence rate, and people who are diabetics, who are obese, who are younger, who have large discs, they have a higher recurrence rate. But for discectomies, I say about 98-99%, the recurrence rate is about 2-3%. In diabetics, is about 4-6%. So I give them, but I also give them an example that this percentage is all relative. It is only applicable if you climb up the ladder 100 times and come down, that's 2 times you will fall and 98 times you will not fall. But 100 patients are climbing the ladder at 100 different times. So it is just a relative thing. So I explain that to them also, because otherwise they would then come back to you and say, look, sir, aapne to bola tha, theek ho jayega, recurrence kaise ho gaya?
I would like to ask the same question to Arvind. In your practice, how much percent you tell? Because this is a very common...
Yeah. He's raising his fingers. He wants to answer something.
Yeah. See, the most important part in discectomy is the counseling part. I never operate a patient without counseling him. And it basically, you know, there is literature. You have a big annular tear. You know, there's an incidence of close to 21% of recurrence. If it is a small annular tear, it's about 5%. So I give them a range that, you know, it could exceed somewhere between, it would be somewhere between 5 to 21%. And if you counsel them well, they usually, you know, when if they come back with recurrence, it's very easy to discuss. And if you're not discuss, then it's a problem. And when I have to fuse also, I give them all the scenario, I quote them the scenario. My indication is basically a failed annular incompetence, a contained disc with the annular incompetence, where the patient gets discogenic pain on flexion, that is sitting, forward bending, etc. When the disc bulges like a tire, blown tire, and causes dural compression. So then they get this radicular pain. So that is my indication. In those cases, I tell them I'm not going to do a discectomy, I'm going to fuse you.
Okay.
Primary?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah, would you fuse them primarily, Arvind?
Yeah, if it is an annular incompetence, you know, it is a contained disc, patient gets pain on flexion dominance and, you know, get relieved on extension. So this is not actually a disc herniation. It's a disc bulge which manifests on flexion. So these patients don't do well with discectomy alone, especially the young ones.
Arvind, you take video consent?
No.
I would like to ask Dr. Guru Raj. Do you take your consent, Guru?
Actually, we are not practicing video consent. There is a printed format. And then we do take a special consent and explain them everything. I have seen when I was with Lenke and whoever was with Lenke, you might have seen, they do explain a 1% chance of death, blindness and everything. So you make a passing comment if they are really, really inquisitive, if you feel that they are actually understand the things. But then if for a layman, you just explain them about neurological deficits, infection, CSF leak, maybe a recurrent surgery and recurrent disc, and maybe a need of effusion, if at all there is a instability happens, or there is a recurrent disc, you might need another discectomy or a fusion. So you take all these consents, but then if the patient is really very, very knowledgeable and they ask too many questions, and then I do go do them and explain them about blindness also, and I just tell them, kuch bhi ho sakta hai anesthesia mein. There is a chance of life risk also. So it all depends on how your conversation goes with the patient. Actually, we all agree that whatever decisions we make, whether we fuse, whether we do discectomy, or whether we do primary fusion, or whether we do secondary fusion, it all depends on from patient to patient, how your conversation goes about with the patient. You have some thinking within yourself that I want to do this. You want to explain all that to the patient. But then if patient asks you too many questions, then you will say, oh, there is a 15% chance of recurrence. If you don't want to take that chance, go ahead and get it fusion done. But then you will explain them the fusion complications also.
Okay. I would like to ask Appaji, in Tamil Nadu, do you explain the patient in the language they understand, the Tamilian language, and whether you check the consent also in Tamilian language?
Yeah, that's a rule which we follow since I think 2008 or something, when the government and the Madras High Court are somewhere, there was a case, and then they said the consent should be in the vernacular language. So the consent is usually in two languages. One is in English and one is in the local language, or whatever the language the patient speaks. Because we get lots of patients from Andhra too. So Telugu speaking, some of them are Bengali patients. So we have Bengali translators sitting in the hospital. So we have consent forms in Bengali, Telugu and Tamil. Second thing about the fusion bar, this thing about discectomy, Silas, you will remember, we were sitting for a coffee in Oberoi, and your boss, Manoj Krishna, know his name?
Yes.
From UK. He said, he fuses all L5S1s. You remember that? He fuses every disc at L5S1. He will not do a discectomy at all. So we were just laughing that day. And now to hear that some people think of a primary fusion for L5S1 disc is a good thing.
Yeah.
That's what I want to say. Yeah. Dr. Karne wanted to say something for long.
Yes, Karne, sir.
Well, there are two different things. One is about the consent, as you said. The consent has to be taken in the mother tongue of the patient. That is, the consent is taken for the medico-legal purpose. And the counseling is done for our understanding between the patient and us. So as far as consent is concerned, it is should be the mother tongue of the patient. Video consent doesn't have much standing in the court. The only thing is, your consent should mention all possible complications. You know, there is another part. In some of the cases, that particular complication was not mentioned in the consent. And even when doctor has not done nothing wrong, the complication can occur. Still, the doctor was held guilty because that particular complication was not mentioned in the consent. So your consent should mention all possible complications during anesthesia, during surgery, and during post-op period also. That is as far as consent is concerned. Now the counseling. In the counseling, I give example to the patients. I explain him, so see, this is like a puncture in a tire or a wheel. You know, I am just taking care of the puncture which is right now. I am removing the disc which is offending to you. But when the next puncture will occur, that I cannot tell you.
Okay.
You can get the puncture within 2 weeks also, and you may not get the puncture in next 20 years also. So my job is just to take care of your puncture, and your job is to take care of your spine so that it will not get punctured. That's how then patient understands that the recurrence is possible, and that is not in my hands. Whether the recurrence will be there or not, it depends upon the patient, how he takes the care. Third thing, as far as fusion and the only discectomy is concerned, it is a surgeon's prerogative. Patient is not bothered whether you're doing fusion or not. What patient wants, that he wants a painless spine and with all the mobility. You do fusion, you don't do the fusion, all those things are there. Generally, patients are not much bothered about it. So as far as fusion is concerned, it is a call of a doctor or a surgeon. Patient wants just a painless joint and as far as possible, no recurrence.
Dr. Karne is known for his knowledge and support for Maharashtra Orthopedic Association and Pune Orthopedic Society in legal sale. He has extensive work in this aspect. And thank you, Karne sir, for enlightening us. And last question, why this? Because in disc and fusion, these are the very, very important things which we are discussing, not only the core topic. The debates are coming in just a minute or two. I just would like to ask Dr. Pradyuman, who is working at Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, and it's catered a huge amount of COVID patients. And Pradyuman, in last 1.5 years now, what is your take on when patient is coming to the hospital, whether you explain that there is a possibility that the relative or someone can get affected with COVID?
Why relative? The patient also can get COVID. So I think in COVID times, you should be careful. So we also take a now, I mean, not only us, I think all hospitals also take a COVID consent. And normally we had stopped elective surgeries. We have started elective surgeries only when 3 weeks, the data has shown that weekly there is a fall in cases. So only once there is a weekly fall in cases for last 3 weeks that we have started with elective surgeries now since last week. So during the pandemic, obviously you need to take COVID consent also, not only for the patient, relatives, everyone. Even as a doctor, I say I am taking risk while operating you because I can also get COVID from you.
Okay.
So it's not a patient, but everyone who's treating the patient can get COVID.
Okay, perfect. Perfect, Pradyuman. And last question to Himanshu. When patient comes to you, Himanshu, and you talk about fusion and you're talking about Indian implants versus import implants, what is the justification you explain them? What is better, superior, or your results are same? What do you tell them? Why you want to use imported for someone who is affording, or why you don't want to use imported? So is there any justification you give in your practice?
There is no point actually about justification. I give them this choice whether I want to go for Indian or imported implants. So it's actually their choice, obviously. So what I tell them, it's like this thing is going to take you places, but whether you drive a Corolla or you drive a Mercedes, both are good cars, but if you want a brand, you can go for it. And actually in this surgery, I am your driver. So for me, driving a Mercedes is going to be a better experience because I'm going to take you to a destination. For me, a simple car would be difficult. So it is all about the instrumentations which I use during the surgery. So your surgery is going to be a little easy. It's not about the implants, because probably we all have been, all of you senior people have been using Indian implants for a lot of years and they give good results. So I tell them it's not actually about your implants. It's about how I put those implants in your body. So it is going to be the ease of surgery. So if you want me to take to your destination in a Mercedes in a faster way and a better way, I will do that. I can do that in a car which is little less expensive than Mercedes also, and okay, in a good way. That's all.
Okay, we'll come to this point again, and we would like to start the debate, and I would like to invite Dr. Pradyuman Pairaiturkar for the opening session of the debate. Over to you, Pradyuman. L4-5 okay. Large disc. Why do I decompress?
Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes, Pradyuman, yes.
Just a minute. Yeah, so I think my job has been made easier by the comments which everyone has made prior to me. And actually, lumbar disc herniation is the bread and butter for all orthopedic surgeons, spine surgeons, neurosurgeons, either in its management as surgical or non-surgical. And obviously, in spite of all that has been written, been practiced, its management is still intriguing. And there are challenges, gray zones. Unfortunately, Shailesh and your team, you have selected a wrong topic for the debate, like a large lumbar disc herniation, discectomy or fusion, because it is crystal clear now that there is no debate on what is right. Almost no role for fusion as the standard procedure as a primary procedure for large disc herniation. And I guess it is a uphill task for Guru Raj to defend the same. So the motion for today's debate is large lumbar disc herniation, discectomy or fusion. And I guess every one of us agrees that fusion is not as a primary procedure for any disc herniation for that matter. That brings down to the basic question. I have no disclosures to make. Is lumbar disc herniation big or small? Does size really matter? So obviously, everyone will agree size really matters in most other things. But whether in disc herniation size matters, we'll see. So what do you mean by large lumbar disc herniation? It's also called as massive or giant. It should occupy more than 50% in the axial MRI section. Now, whenever we see a large lumbar disc herniation, if we correlate clinically, then the presentation is very, very, obviously all of us have seen patients who are asymptomatic and just on screening, they have a huge large disc. But when you ask them even probing questions, they have absolutely no symptoms. Some obviously have mild back pain because he's been coming to you for a very long time. You ask him to do an MRI, it shows a large disc. The obviously commonest is radicular leg pain, and very rarely sometimes you have a large lumbar disc with cauda equina syndrome. So the radicular leg pain or a combination of leg pain and back pain is the most common presentation. And obviously a rarer thing is having an intradural disc herniation. So in pathophysiology for any lumbar disc herniation, the main cause for this thing is compression of neural elements. And obviously the basic treatment remains decompression by discectomy and targeted fragmentectomy. Now, how you do a discectomy is debatable, but there is no debate on whether you should do a discectomy or a fusion. So we can debate on how you can do a discectomy in patients with symptomatic lumbar disc herniations. Now, again, as we know, asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic, even though they are very large, you need not treat them prophylactically. So there is no role for prophylactic surgeries in asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. There are enough papers who have followed them, and you know that large lumbar disc herniations can also resolve. So surgical decompression or discectomy is reserved for symptomatic individuals and obviously for a more predictable outcome. We all see patients who have a very large disc, we advise them surgery, but they don't want to undergo surgery. And the same patient comes to us in maybe 3 months, 4 months with mild symptoms or this thing, and he says, I'm better. At the same time, you get to see patients who are worsening and may come with a neurodeficit. So in asymptomatic large disc herniation, you should have a concept of masterly inactivity with close follow-up for symptom appearance or progression. Now in symptomatic, how you do a discectomy depends on your choice. It depends on your experience, your training, and definitely newer techniques can also be used to treat large lumbar disc herniations successfully, and size of herniation really does not matter. So I'll be telling how I apply all these scenarios in all this, but I agree with Dr. Shankar that the main aim of doing any surgery is to be safe. So you have to have a safe spine surgery. So do no harm to the patient. So don't consider your patient as a guinea pig of trying out new surgeries, especially a central disc herniation. So if you are in a training situation where you are getting trained in endoscopic discectomy, central disc herniation is not the first surgery you should undergo. That's a disclaimer I would like to make. So this is a 35-year-old male with a very obese male with a large L4-5 right-sided disc herniation. Now I treated this endoscopically transforaminal, whereby this is just a video, small video to show it. The transforaminal axis is good because you keep all the posterior structures virgin. You are targeting directly the herniation. You reach the base of the herniation. So this is the herniation over here where you see. You cut the annulus slightly so as to reach the base of the herniation, and you can remove the fragment completely. At the same time, you can sometimes get the same fragment in single piece, but most of the times it is piecemeal. The most important thing you should do in this is you have to correlate whatever removed matches with whatever you expect from the MRI. Because most of the times, the problem with endoscopic discectomy, especially transforaminal, is because of remnant fragments which continue to give postoperative pain. Because it is done under local anesthesia, it is very patient friendly. And since it is done under...
The thing is that we have a lot of people catching post-COVID infections.
And so
it is better to first get an MRI. If the MRI is normal, then we just need to give him anti-inflammatory medications to suppress
this. Is
but first we have got to see that there is nothing inside.
Yeah. Hi. Okay. So this is the pre- and post-operative MRI. So you can see there's the water, because of the, we use water, this is immediate post-op MRI, you can see, but there is no, the herniation has been removed.
At this point, then we can only give him an anti-inflammatory.
Now, this is another patient with a 35-year-old female with left leg pain, significant large
cause of the pain, we have to assume that it's myositis.
Someone has to mute.
Inflammation of the muscles.
Hello, Mihir.
Due to COVID or due to bed rest or due to oxygen deficiency.
Hello, Mihir.
You know, all these, if you are...
I will just check.
Not so in this case, also I did transforaminal discectomy, and I could just remove in the first shot such a large fragment, and she was completely asymptomatic the moment I removed it, hardly 10-minute procedure under local anesthesia. So this is the preoperative MRI and this is the postoperative MRI. Again, transforaminal axis for large disc herniation. The pros are it's absolutely patient friendly under local anesthesia. Posterior structures integrity mentioned is maintained. Why I need to mention this is because all we know that whatever we do primarily, we cannot absolutely prevent a recurrent disc herniation. So if there is a need for a revision procedure, if you have done a transforaminal axis, posterior structures integrity is very important if you want to revise it by a microdiscectomy. Otherwise, also, if you have done a microdiscectomy, you can do the revision procedure through a transforaminal axis. The cons are you can have in a fragmented disc, there is a chance of a remnant fragment, which can be symptomatic. And transforaminal axis is not good for extruded, sequestered, large disc herniation. So consider this. This is a L4-5 large extruded disc herniation. It is so much extruded that it is lying. The fragment is lying posterior to the thecal sac. The thecal sac is not even seen. Now, this was a 51-year-old male, and he was insistent on an endoscopic procedure. I took a consent from him that we will try an endoscopic procedure, but I may not be able to guarantee you. I may have to convert it into open. So in this case, because it was an extruded and sequestered disc, we tried to do it through an interlaminar way. So we used the same endoscope through the interlaminar window. So it is definitely the choice of surgery. So what Mihir had presented the first time, I would have done a L5-S1 interlaminar full endoscopic discectomy. So whatever the size of the herniation does not matter. It is not recommended higher levels above than L4-5, that is L3-4, L2-3, it is not recommended. But L4-5, if you have a good interlaminar window, it is a very good choice. So this is the case. And this is the video of the same patient. So I managed to do it endoscopically, but this might not be true every time. So you have to take a consent for an open procedure. So here we, the L4-5, we put the dilator, we put the cannula. And then in this case, you have to remove, you have to make a, so this is some inter muscles which are there lying posteriorly. You see the ligamentum flavum below. You have to make a nick in the ligamentum flavum so as to enter the canal. In this case, as we had anticipated, because the fragment was lying posterior to the dural sac, immediately after making a hole in the ligamentum flavum. So this is, we are making a hole in the ligamentum flavum. So once we go inside the ligamentum flavum, we were fortunate to see the disc herniation lying posterior to the dural sac. So we could not see the thecal sac. We could identify directly the disc herniation. Again, we removed it piecemeal. So you removed the herniation piecemeal and then you could see the thecal sac. You go lateral to the nerve root and you can retract it. Now, mind well, at L4-5, you should not retract with a fixed cannula for a very long time, but to visualize the, if any fragment is there anteriorly, you can retract it for some time to see if there is any fragment in front. So this is how you can retract the thecal sac. And so this is the completely decompressed thecal sac and the fragment which has been removed. There's again, L5-S1 interlaminar. Again, very easy to do interlaminar endoscopically. Once you start doing it, you will realize that it is much, much easier and faster than any other procedure. So you have to place your cannula and at L5-S1, since your interlaminar window is quite big, it is very, very easy. I won't skip the video. So interlaminar endoscopic discectomy, the advantage is that it's a familiar anatomy to all surgeons. There is less scarring as compared to microdiscectomy, is good visualization and less chances of remnant fragment as compared to transforaminal axis. Obviously, the con is retraction of the neural elements. So you have a lot of papers. I think Himanshu is going to talk on some, but these are papers which talk about endoscopic discectomy in large disc herniations. And the recurrence rate in all this is, in though they are small series of maybe 40 or odd patients, the recurrence rate is less than 10% on treating with endoscopic discectomy, and which were, if the recurrence was also treated with endoscopic discectomy later on. Again, this compares to endoscopic discectomy with open lumbar discectomy. So results are comparable, but the patient satisfaction was better with endoscopic, and the improvement of back pain also better with endoscopic discectomy. The endoscopic discectomy advantage, if you have a recurrent large disc herniation where you have a scar in between, you can, in selected contained herniations, you can go transforaminal, so you can avoid the scar and the patient can have a good result. Now, talking about microdiscectomy or tubular discectomy or endoscopic assisted UBE, all procedures are same. I would like to mention that in case of a large disc herniation, some points have to be followed. One is you should do minimal bone resection as much as essential, preserving the pars and facet. Again, with the thing that since it's a large disc herniation, you want to go lateral, so you tend to remove more bone. But the more bone you remove, the more chances that if the patient requires a second surgery, you may not be, the next time you may have to convert it into a fusion because there is less bone preserved. You do minimal muscle injury. And obviously, there is no role for a radical discectomy or with curettage of the disc. A limited discectomy with removal of loose fragments is enough. Always give a disc wash with normal saline, which helps in flushing out the loose fragments responsible for early recurrence. Now, this is an interesting case. This is a two open surgeries, L5-S1, at the same time, but subsequent. The L4-5 had caused a foot drop for him, which was not recovered. And this time he came with a large central disc herniation at L3-4, but this time with the cauda equina syndrome. Now, in such case, it is an unsolved problem, as Shankar has mentioned about the case which he had said, that why a same person is having repeated disc herniations at different levels. In such case, since there was a cauda equina, I didn't want to take chances with endoscopy. I wanted to decompress him fully. So I decided to go in for an open microdiscectomy. The problem in microdiscectomy was, I tried and tried, but I could not get any plane. So I checked whether it was right, but there was no disc which was seen over there. And the dural sac was very tight. So I thought there were a lot of adhesions, but after struggling for around 2 hours trying to go lateral to the disc, I was confused. And then I realized that probably it was intradural. So next I went in, I took a incision, and there, to my surprise, I found that the entire disc was in the dural sac. So this is a very rare case. I tried to search literature. There are only few case reports. So there was a large disc herniation within the thecal sac, and which was responsible for the dense neurodeficit he had. Now, coming to why fusion has been recommended. So as Arvind was mentioning, if the annular tail is large, there is a lot of annular incompetence. The presumption is that recurrence is more with large central disc herniations. And so, na rahega baj na bajegi basri. So you fuse the disc and then the patient will not come for any problems later on. The other premise is you want to treat back pain associated with disc degeneration. So if somebody is coming with back pain and leg pain, back pain is more, you fuse it along with discectomy. I think that is too much to think about, because all these reports are anecdotal. I found this paper which studied giant lumbar disc herniations of 154 patients over a decade after just a microdiscectomy. And their recurrence rate was 1.94 compared to a control group of other lumbar disc herniations, which was 6. Similar, this is your So thank you for having that with us. So the outcomes of discectomy in young adults with large central disc herniations with predominant leg pain, you have a 93% good outcome and just 6% recurrence. This is by Dr. Chhabra from lumbar interbody fusion surgeries with discectomy for massive lumbar disc herniation. And his conclusion for Indian scenario is very important. The discectomy patients show overall more satisfaction. Overall complication rates on long-term follow-up are also less. And in developing countries where resources are limited, discectomy is the preferred procedure. Even then, you
is there is a network issue?
Yeah, probably he got disconnected.
I think, yeah, but I think Pradyuman really played it very well and very safe. And initially he disclosed that this is not a debate. This is a clear cut mandate that, yeah, Pradyuman, hi.
Sorry, my connection got lost.
Yeah, anything else you wanted to add up?
Just a minute. So the recurrence rate in PLD was just 14 out of 184, that is around 7%. So I refuse to fuse for every symptomatic large lumbar disc herniation. Fusion for me is an overkill, is unphysiological, and is the most invasive procedure. It has got a significant chances of ASD. Fusion is definitely effective because decompression is an integral part of it. So you can't say that fusion is less effective than discectomy. Discectomy is the way to go. No
I think Pradyuman's connection is little weaker, but yes, Pradyuman. You want to summarize now, Pradyuman?
Yeah, I'm going to summarize last two slides only.
As it's a debate, it's important for us to know the last slide also.
Yes, so just a minute.
You're holding on.
Yeah. So there is no study which has shown that the recurrence rate is more than 15% max. On the contrary, a lot of studies show a rate of symptomatic.
No, I think, thank you, Pradyuman, for your presentation. We have understood that you will go for decompression and discectomy. One, two things I just wanted to say that endoscopy and minimal invasive techniques really look very good, and the recurrence is always an issue in any decompression discectomy we do. One thing I think probably Pradyuman has added, the topics selectively given was L4-5 only, large L4-5 disc. But it's good for us that he has shown us 3-4 and 5-1 also. But the topic of debate mainly is L4-5. And we would like Dr. Gururaj to come forward for his presentation, yeah, and we will have a healthy discussion.
Thank you, Shailesh. First of all, Shailesh, as Pradyuman told me, he has given me a tough job of defending a fusion, which looks me look like a butcher in front of actually a spine surgeon, where it's very difficult to defend a fusion in a forum like this. But then I would do my justice to my topic. And I would counter Pradyuman on his words, word by word. So when there is a large disc herniation like this, there are definitely multiple options. It's not only the endoscopic procedures, or it's not a interlaminar endoscopic procedures. And Pradyuman might be able to do a extruded fragment or a dorsally migrated fragment also through endoscope, but not all can do the same thing. So that is why the debate exists. I wouldn't agree with Pradyuman that there is no debate. Definitely there debate exists. Pradyuman categorically said size does not matter. size does matter. That is why we are discussing this topic, because largest herniations come with their own problems. That is why size does matter, Pradyuman. And you made it look like very simple. Large discs are not that simple. They have their own problems. I will deal with one by one. So you made it look like a very, very simple large disc herniations. It's not that simple. Maybe I would say in 30 to 50% of the times, you are caught with your pants down when you operate on these large discs. So be careful when we say these large discs, there is no debate, or we can operate everything through only by doing discectomy. And that is why I think he didn't justify only discectomy. He showed mainly the techniques. He didn't actually address the topic, I would say. And maybe for endoscopic surgeons, the revision surgery is simple, but I would say revision surgery is not simple, not for the patient. Patient will not want to undergo repeated surgeries. Even if you explain to them that you might need a second surgery, I would agree, everybody in this forum will agree that whenever you explain a second surgery to the patient, more than 50% of them get annoyed. They start abusing, they start counteracting, they go to somebody else, they spoil your name. So revision surgery is not simple. I would say I would attempt an endoscopic surgery, and then if not possible, if there is a failure, I would go ahead and do a different kind of surgery. So it's for Indian scenario, especially everybody wants one-time solution. If people might not agree to this, but then in our hearts, every damn surgeon knows this, that people want one-time solution. So be careful when you choose your procedures, choose them rightly. And I didn't see any follow-ups of Pradyuman's cases. I did see beautiful immediate post-op MRIs, but I didn't see any of the basically follow-up MRIs. So let's have the debate. I would not agree that there is no debate. There is a debate. That is why we are debating today. So I would not want to sound like a butcher with knife in my hand. I want to cut everybody open and do fusions. This is a big, massive, large disc. No instabilities, no caveats attached. I also did a tubular microdiscectomy in this case. But then in all cases, only the tubular discectomy doesn't suffice. Why is that? So keyhole surgeons, they are very much fascinated and enter into this keyhole and they get stuck. So we shouldn't get stuck like this in the keyholes. So, but whatever the outcome of the debate would be, in the end, I would hope after this pandemic, me and Pradyuman will have a beer or two in the evening. So this already Pradyuman has dealt with this. What is a large or a massive disc or a giant disc? So what we need to understand is what we need when we operate on these patients, or any patient for that matter, we need a happy patient. If we have a dissatisfied patient, it is not good for anyone. So that is why for each problem to treat, we need to understand the etiology of a problem. Then only you can address the cause. So what is the etiology of a basically a large herniated disc? You see these herniated discs most commonly in those patients who are manual laborers, who lift heavy weights and traction injuries, and people who have hypermobility problems. And then this usually happens in the productive age group. And this usually happens in people who are obese. So if for a manual labor, you just do a discectomy and then he gets another recurrent disc, or he gets a recurrent stenosis or an instability or a discectomy back, you are not doing anything good for him, because his work requires a lot of hard work. So you have to give him a stable, pain-free back. And then in hypermobility individuals, you are missing the point there, that these patients can have instabilities. And in productive age group, if you don't give them a stable back and you keep on operating them, so it has been found that we all know that if a person is not going back to the work for 1 year, it is less likely that 60 to 70% will go back to their original work. So we should not term fusion as a devil. it has its own place, and we have to address by case by case basis. What are the characteristics of a large base? It is not that simple, like Pradyuman tried to mention. Most of these discs are central with paracentral component, and they are migrated up and down. Most, they can be calcified discs. Like Arvind mentioning, they have large annular rents, annular incompetence, because they've been lying there since a long time. You have seen adhesions more in large discs as compared to smaller discs. And you can be surprised with these discs being intradural. And there can be foraminal extension. These discs can be bilateral. You might have to do a bilateral discectomy, creating more instability. And if you don't do dynamic X-rays in these patients, you miss those subtle instabilities, or some of these patients will have a kyphotic deformity, especially at L4-5 region. So if you don't concentrate on these things, and you just go ahead and say that I would do a microdiscectomy, or I would do just a discectomy or an endoscopic discectomy, and you promise patient, then you are going to have an unsatisfied patient. So you're inviting trouble for yourself. So keep your mind open, think about all these things and see them, and then decide whether you want to go ahead and do a just discectomy. And then again, what we miss and what we all know right now is most of the large discs have end plate failures. And we also know that when there is an end plate failure, the back pain chances are more and the recurrence chances are more. So if we say that only recurrence is less, that is not enough. We have to see actively that there is any end plate failure. And then like I was mentioning, you have to look for instability. You have to look for calcification, because in calcification, if there is predominantly a calcified disc, you will have to do a discectomy and create a big annular void, and you will create instability there. So that is why you need to look for calcification and intradural, as we were mentioning. So this is one of the intradural discs, and we have published this paper in the Asian Journal of Neurosurgery, and there is a series of 4 to 5 cases in this paper. And then again, what I was mentioning, this calcified disc, these discs, if you see, if you don't take out this calcified part and try to take out this portion, and then when you do this, you are going to create instability. So you have to be careful when you say, I can just go ahead and do a discectomy. And then what are the special characteristics? They have severe hyperalgesia, and they do have a bilateral sciatica symptom. And weakness is more as pronounced compared to a smaller disc. And they do have a severe back pain as compared to a smaller disc. And then quad equina syndrome is more likely in larger disc as compared to a smaller disc. So when we have already pre-existing neural deficits, if you meddle around with the neural structures there, you are creating more neurological worsening as compared to in a smaller disc. So be careful when there is a pre-existing neural deficits, how much you want to meddle around with the nervous tissue. And then what happens? We saw in first case of Dr. Pradyuman that when he took out the large herniated disc from there, the disc has actually collapsed. That's why I was asking about the follow-up. In the long run, when the disc height reduces, the foraminal height also gets reduced. So this causes root compression, and it causes persistent radiculopathy or a recurrence of radiculopathy. And along with that, facet arthritis can happen and cause a persistent discogenic and facetal back pain. And then what is another problem with the large disc? That is, collapse of the disc space can lead to degenerative listhesis scenario with or without instability. So it might need a further decompression in future. So be careful, discuss with your patients all the possibilities and involve your patient in your decision making and go ahead and do a surgery. Unilaterally, don't declare to the patient, I would do only this procedure in your case. So the next thing is large disc. There can be pre-existing severe degeneration Or when you do a discectomy, there can be accelerated degeneration, which causes residual back pain or a recurrence of back pain, because it is proven that a large disc herniation is prone to cause modic type 2 changes in large disc herniation. And again, we have to see this association, that is there a facet tropism? If there is a sagittally oriented facet, then if you do a big chunk of discectomy, and then there can be accelerated degeneration causing a degenerative discthesis. So we have to be very careful of this unholy alliance of large disc with these factors, that is obesity, elderly age group, facet tropism, and pre-existing modic changes. Because pre-existing type 2 modic changes, they do cause unsatisfactory results in your post-operative period. And what are the technical problems? Dr. Pradyuman touched upon these things, but then all said and done, it's easy to say, but difficult to execute. Because when you see that there's a tensed thecal sac with a nerve root really flattened out on the large disc, and you have already existing quad equina syndrome or already existing neural deficits, to retract these nerve roots and take out the disc is very, very difficult. It can be possible in a transforaminal endoscopy, but when most of the people are doing a micro discectomy or open discectomy or a tubular discectomy, it's really, really difficult. So we have to be very careful. So that is why, whatever said and done, people who do midline discectomies, they know that they tend to cut a little bit of more bone as compared to the usual discectomies. So it can lead on to iatrogenic instability. And it needs a nerve root retraction, which we dealt. It can cause further neurological deficits, dorsal root ganglion irritations, especially in transforaminal discectomies. So I would ask Dr. Pradyuman after my talk, how many times did he see actually a dorsal root ganglion irritation when he does a transforaminal discectomy for these large fragments? And incidental dural tear and CSF leaks are, again, this is proven well beyond doubt that it is very common when we try to do just a discectomy, especially in central and in large disc where there can be adhesions. And pre-existing neurodeficits we already discussed. So we have to be very careful. We have to see the demography of the patient, that is occupation. I'm sorry, I think I didn't put the animation there. So education level of the patient. Basically, high demand jobs, can't modify his activities, Indian household workers, and people really need to squat. So all these people, you need to really, really discuss with them what is the outcome of your surgery, what you're offering, what they can do after your surgery, what they cannot do after your surgery, and then involve them in decision making and do a shared decision. I'm not saying go ahead and do fusion in every case, but then be prepared to fuse them. And then again, a big debate over ASD. Again, I'm quoting from a review article, that is, adjacent segment disease is common, but does not correlate with functional outcomes. So we all know in our hearts, and we have discussed it many times, that adjacent segment disease is common, but symptomatic adjacent segments are really, really less common. And again, we all know that when we operate on a revision cases, operating on an adjacent segment is more simpler as compared to operating on a level which has been already operated because of the scarring, because of the adhesions. And that is why it causes more chances of CSF leaks, more chances of neurological damage. And we also know how to prevent adjacent segment disease. Protect the facet joints, have an idea about sagittal balance, and preserve midline structures, which is very important to prevent adjacent segment. Because whenever there is requirement of a fusion, we do fusion. And then how many of them, they come back with adjacent segment disease, which is symptomatic, which requires a surgery. You do radiologically see adjacent segment disease, but then very few of them, they do need surgery. So I think adjacent segment disease, which is symptomatic, is a hype phenomenon. So these are some few of the cases where I have to show I have done a fusion. So this is a large migraine. So we did a fusion in this. Again, one more case, a central disc with a deficit. Again, we did a fusion here. And then you see that there is a double level disc. We did a one level fusion and one level just a discectomy. So this is some literature evidence. We all know that literature can be found for both for and against. So I'm not going to really go into in depth of these literatures. Whatever literature I have put in my favor. Obviously, I won't put literature in favor of Pradyuman. So is it worth to fuse in large discs? Yes, but not all. Keep your eyes open and do fusions whenever it is necessary. So whenever there is a disc collapse can happen, degenerative listasis can happen, foraminal stenosis can happen, persistent discogenic back pain can happen, iatrogenic instabilities can happen, traction injuries can happen, DRG irritations can happen, and surgeon-induced cauda equina can happen. So that is why if you are in doubt, if you are not expert like Dr. Pradyuman, which he is, you have to consider your options carefully. So last thing is, don't get caught with your pants down. Be careful, choose your patients properly. Thank you.
Very well presented, Guru Raj, the star batsman of Delhi Capitals. And we compliment both the presenters doing excellent job in defending their cases and the way they practice. But I think it's the selection of the patient which is important. It's Pradyuman also fuses his cases and Guru Raj also decompresses his spine. So this is a debate, but we want to enlighten about the practice, you know, and when the patient comes, a lot of time we are puzzled, we are confused. Patient is with back pain and patient is with leg pain. Back pain is more, leg pain is less. Whether we should fix it and forget it, large disc, all these things are there. I would like to know from Arvind.
Yeah, so my practice is quite straightforward. And see this, you can divide them, you know, as young and classify them as young and old patients. Old patients, you know, they have stiffness because of facet arthritis, et cetera, et cetera. Even degen listasis, we don't fuse many of them. So those are the situations wherein the disc is has a hard annulus. It's a calcified disc or it's a calcified annulus. Again, we have a paper on that. These patients usually come with stenosis. We don't even touch the disc, just inspect it and just do a lateral decompression. In young patients, that is where the challenge comes. So these patients where there is a tall disc, central disc, and you know, patients has pain, we divide them, classify them as back dominant and leg dominant pain. So if you ask them where the main pain is, if they show their back, mid back, and then it goes down, and it's mainly on, you know, flexion dominance, these are the patients I may probably get away with just doing a discectomy, but these are the patients where the back, where it is mainly back dominant, I fuse them. And where it is leg dominant, so leg starts right from the buttock, and if they say it is a leg dominant pain, and you know, the disc is more on one side, so these are the patients I do a discectomy alone. And most important part of the entire thing is you can't keep the patient is an awake patient. He's not a guinea pig. So we can discuss here what we did and what we didn't do, but he is a very important part of the decision making process. Counseling is very, very important. You need to talk about recurrence. You need to talk about possibility of recurrence and what will you do next, and socially what is it is more acceptable to him.
Yeah, Arvind, I would like to ask you, Shankar sir, and even Meer, which patients in your practice you found that like patient is got a discectomy and is coming back at the same level recurrence, or a patient has got a fusion and is coming at an adjacent segment disc, which are the patients which will understand it better? You understand?
So most patients do understand. Even you know, patient who comes from interiors of Maharashtra will understand about all this.
No. The question is whether the patient will. Yeah, Meer.
Can I take that?
Yes.
I think the most important thing is that whether you have seen that patient only on the first time and taken a decision, or whether you have given a fair conservative trial. See, what happens is an acute disc has a lot of inflammation, not only of the pulposus, but also of the annulus. And when you have a large contained disc and you have done an annulotomy, the recurrence rates in an acute disc is far more than discs which have had time to heal over a period of time. And then you just open the annulus and do a fragmentectomy. Secondly, contained discs which are large versus sequestrated and extruded fragments where the nature has helped you. By egressing the fragment, you just pick out the fragment and let you just inspect the rent. If the rent has sealed, you don't touch the disc. So all these factors are playing, and it is always better that you observe these patients multiple times before straight away jumping large disc, I need a surgery, unless there is a pressing neurological or a factor which is prompting you to take a decision on the first day.
Very well said, Arvind and Mir. One thing what I was asking is, if the patient is coming back at the same level recurrence in a discectomy and the patient is coming at adjacent segment, probably, yes, your counseling is important. How many times you're seen is important. But the patient probably will be thinking that at the same level, there is a disc, whether this surgery is not completely done or is incomplete surgery. In a new level, we can always say, yeah, this is a fusion which has gone well and there is adjacent segment. I would like to know from Shankar, sir. Yeah.
That's a defensive answer. Say, because I would always like to say, "Mera surgery acha hai adjacent segment pe ho gaya." It's a defensive answer.
No.
But it's a practical answer also.
I agree with you. So let me come to that point. See, I think what Guru said is perfectly important. After a surgery, once you have taken an incision, whether it is leg pain, back pain, recurrence, infection, everything is connected to the surgery. The surgeon is going to blame you on the first month, after 1 year, after 5 years. They are always going to come back and ask you this question, surgery mein kuch to rahe nahi gaya. Because nobody wants a second surgery by choice. Now, unfortunately, there are two parts. If we accept that nobody wants a second surgery by choice, you are subjecting 100% patients to fusion. Okay, that is a blanket statement. Secondly, is that if you want to subject a portion of these to a discectomy, then accept a recurrence. Am I confused? Thank you very much.
Yes, Shankar sir.
Shailesh, but again, we are assuming that when you do fusion, patient will not have complications because of fusion. Your screw might go inside the canal, your cage might back out. So it is not, it's not
even. See, I'm not saying like that, Arvind. Even infection can happen in even simple discectomy. Yeah, it is not that.
Your routine is 100% simple discectomy. You can cause dural.
Yes, Guru.
Arvind, continue.
No, what I mean to say is fusion doesn't mean you're giving him 100%. There are complications intrinsic to that surgery itself.
Yeah. So my only.
As Amir said, you cannot do a blanket 100, you can't use all 100 patients of disc herniation who come to you just because you occasionally get a recurrence.
Yeah, we are understanding. But Arvind, the thing is, what I'm saying is, the patient's mind, I'm not talking surgeon's mind. See, for the patient, if a recurrence at the same level L4-5, the patient comes to you, they probably will feel it's incomplete.
If you counsel the patient well.
Yeah, counseling, yes, we understand. But just take 100 patients and 100 set of adjacent segment. So probably it's easier to convince the ASD patient in comparison to the same level discectomy. Let's take Shankar sir's opinion on this.
No, everybody's got emotional. So you can see how a topic can get people emotional. And Shailesh is a clever fellow. He put this topic and there is no real answer. Pradyum showed his technique and Guru showed, he didn't say that he's going to fuse all. He said selectively, I'm going to fuse. So he's going to look at the morphology of the patient. He's going to look at morphology of the disc. He's going to look at the type of the patient. He's going to look at the annular incompetence. He's going to look at the back or leg pain. So we all do the same, but obviously he did his histrionics of Hollywood and Bollywood and Pradyumna showed his technique. So they were all playing besides the pitch of the cricket match. So anyway, I think we all understand that we have biases and I don't think there's a blanket answer, as Mihir said. Of 100 patients with L4-5 disc prolapse, which is large, leave aside intradural disc, which is very rare, leave aside cauda equina, which is differently treated. only a large L4-5 disc with back pain and leg pain. You must have to have understanding of the patient and counsel him, and you must have your gut feeling whether this patient would do good. After looking into all the things, the MRI, the facet, the disc height, the adjacent segment, the end plate problems, his sagittal profile, his profession, his surroundings, his family, his relatives, what from where he comes, and then you offer them. So I think that is the way you do it, and you all do it. But Shailesh really stirred up everyone's emotion, and they got emotional.
Summed up nicely in one sentence.
I think you should ask Shankar right before, so that we can stop all the debate right in the beginning.
Yeah.
and to trust your gut is the basic thing, that you don't have diarrhea on the same day. Otherwise, you're doomed.
No, me, the one of the patient from the Gulf, he had come to us, and he said, when in our country, sir, when the president speaks, nobody speaks.
No. Here, everybody speaks.
I'm giving that weighted to the boss.
I think, Shailesh, what Shankar said is perfectly true.
Yeah, really, true. Absolutely.
At the end, you end up customizing a surgery for that one particular patient.
Yes.
Lot of things run in your mind, and then you take a decision. So whether that decision works or not is those percentages which have no meaning.
So that is why it's a shared decision, which is very, very important. You have to involve your patient.
I think it was a wonderful discussion and a debate. And I think after Mihir's confusion, Pradyuman and Guru Raj have confused us more. So now let's see what the last batsman, the warrior Himanshu, has to say from this point of view. And over to you, Himanshu, about the conclusion from your side for this disc debate.
He's already put a thumbs up. What does it mean? He says he's agreeing to everybody's opinion.
No, you're muted, Himanshu.
Yeah, I agreed to what Dr. Shankar Acharya sir said. So that was the thumbs up, sir.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Sir, I should go in the last for both debates together.
Yeah, you can go in the last. Yeah, that will be because completely demystifying. Yeah, so that's a complete one. And we move on to the next debate of the day. As we have seen a lot of confusions here, and at the end of it, we will have answers with the evidence Dr. Himanshu will be talking about. But before that, the always an ongoing debate about high-grade listhesis. Nowadays, with the new technology, new techniques, everyone is talking about minimal invasive, robotic, OAM, navigation. So many things are coming up. But traditionally, what we always did is open surgery. So let's know from the two stalwarts in spine surgery, Dr. Apaji Krishnan will be talking on standard open surgery for high-grade listhesis, and our other MIS giant Arvind will be talking about the MIS way, how we should do for this difficult topic. Over to you, Apaji, and we have our president for his final verdict. Over to you, Apaji.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. So, Arvind, to tell everybody first, I'm not an MIS person. So I'm a maximally invasive surgeon, and I do some MIS for trauma.
Maximally invasive surgery is also MIS.
So I'm not a minimally invasive surgeon. I do some endoscopic discectomies, yes. I do some trauma fixations, percutaneous fixations. I've done a few TLIFs, but I'm not a huge fan of MIS. Maybe it's a bias on me. So let's debate now. Yeah, so the debate here, I think it's in the high grade spondylolisthesis. So the debate has been happening for long. These two guys used to fight every quite often. As you can see, this picture is from 2005. So the debate was whether to reduce or not to reduce spondylolisthesis that time. This was in 2005. And you know, the thing used to be, the debate should usually used to be, why should spondy be reduced at all? should anyone attempt reduction? Used to be the question. And they used to call us mad. You guys are mad. You guys are doing things which you should not do. It's only for the very brave-hearted. This was Rajshekaran sir's words. This is for the brave-hearted. You guys should not do these surgeries. Regular spine surgeons should not attempt. And quite often, the thing used to be in the coffee shop discussion used to be that, okay, these guys are just farting. They are not giving you a good this thing. They are just showing one case and calling it like 13 cases or 15 cases, and that they reduce spondyloptosis or grade four spondies to like this. And I think one of our first papers, okay, so 2005, 2006, we decided to present it as a paper in ASICON Chandigarh. This was a paper of 13 patients which we had presented. So we know that it's quite uncommon to have very high grade spondylolisthesis in one's practice. Over a period of 25 years now, surgeons and myself, we have collected around 39 cases. And we presented a paper in IMAS 2007. So these were the first steps towards establishing that, okay, spondy can be reduced. And we were doing it in a simple way, open the, spondylolisthesis reduction. I would like to learn from Arvind how to do it otherwise, because I have no idea at all. And year 2010, first demo surgery, we did it in Ganga operative course, grade 5 spondy. And still the consensus during that time was that, okay, hey, guys, you should not attempt all this. This is only for the few spine surgeons who can do these surgeries. But the spine community in India started believing. The youngsters, especially Shailesh and Ketan and Ajay Shetty, Abhay, everybody started believing that, okay, spondy can be reduced and we can do it in a certain way, which we have published. And again, there was a debate in ASICON 2013 in Cochin. They said aggressive reduction versus in situ fixation versus the Gaines procedure. And that time, again, the thing was that the jury was undecided. So they did not say, okay, this is a better procedure. But we all know that Robert Gaines procedure is almost now given up and nobody does that. And this is the year where we had presented and I got the best Charles Ray gold medal award in ISAS. This is a paper which we presented for 27 patients with only one patient having a permanent complication. 26 of the 27 patients doing well. And this is, mind you, a follow-up of how many years? Nearly 20 years, and the minimum follow-up was 5 years. So the patients which we included was 20 years to 5 years. So we are not discussing about this type of a spondy. I know, Arvind, you'll show some x-rays like this and you'll say, okay, I put in a minimally invasive screw, I put in a T-leaf, I do all that. I think we are not discussing about such nicely. You have a good sagittal profile, you have everything, you have a clear anatomy to put in your screws, minimally invasive or otherwise. We are not discussing about such spondies. What we are discussing about is high-grade spondylolisthesis, where by classification, it's either a MAD in grade 3 or higher, high dysplastic with congenital anomalies, a rapidly progressive spondylolisthesis. There is a considered sagittal profile deformity. The patient has had a lumbosacral kyphosis. The issue is of high pelvic incidence and sagittal imbalance in most of these patients. And usual presentation is in adolescents, and sometimes we see it in young adults too. So the classification we all know, and these are the patients. So controversy still exists on what is the most correct procedure, because even last ASICON, I think we had a video demonstration, so somebody showing a Bowlman, I showed a reduction, and somebody showed a delta fixation, that is an in situ fixation, minimally invasive. So case example, this is a patient and that's her x-ray. She is a grade 5 spondylolisthesis with the lumbar sag. The scoliosis, she was referred to as for scoliosis, mind you. And she was found to have a grade 5 spondylolisthesis or a SDSG grade 6, type 6 with a decompensated lumbopelvic parameters. So that's a close-up X-ray, the MRI. So these were the parameters. The pelvic incidence, as you can see, was very, very high. It was 85. So we are looking at patients like this and the L5 lying in front of S1. So the controversy has always been this previously. It used to be in situ fusion reduction, close postural reduction, open reduction. But now Silesh wants us to discuss whether it should be open surgery or a minimal invasive surgery. I do not know, for God's sake, how Arvind is going to put an instrument, or I do not know. Maybe I'm going to learn now how to put a screw into that L5 without opening the spine. So to look into literature, yes, there have been other surgical management. They have done in situ fusion, but they have had more than 50% failures. They were close reduction. This is one of the papers which is very, very important, because we use this technique for positioning a patient during surgery. So we do a close reduction partially before attempting a reduction in the thing. The third one is Bowman's procedure. As I said, there's a high incidence of pseudarthrosis, bending of the fusion mask, because this is from the S2 to L5. This is a fusion mask from S2 to L5. It's a transdural, so there is a high incidence of cardiac venous syndrome in these patients. One of the best is this paper, which reported a perfect reduction. This is from the AO group using an AO external fixator. So they used a fixator, they reduced over 6 weeks' time, but they had a higher incidence of infection. And then we all know about Gaines procedure, where he excised L5. So our procedure is a single step. Open, mind you, open, Arvind, we do not do MIS. So we do an open pedicular screw fixation. We do a wide decompression. We remove the operculum or the rattler, whatever way you want to call it. We correct the lumbosacral kyphosis. So it requires manipulation of the pelvis as well as the pulling off the L5 out of the L5S1 where it is spondyloptosis. And a very gradual reduction. It takes almost 25 minutes to 30 minutes to just reduce that step by step. And then we do a postlateral fusion and also add an interbody fusion, all done in a single stage. So a point on positioning. So we all position, usually you'd have seen patients being positioned that are in the lazy flex, hip flex position for most of the spine surgeries. Either 30 degree or so. But here we do a pelvic extension or a hip extension position so that from a spondyloptosis of 5, the patient reduces to 4 most often. And then you get the 5 realigned to put a screw. Maybe now Arvind can say, oh, I can put a screw in there now. It's not, it's like an easy way to put in a screw. So what we do is to get the space between L5 S1, we do a distraction. This is a procedure described by Professor Harms. He uses hooks actually at S1 and L3. He uses an upgoing and a lowgoing hook. He uses a Harrington rod. He ratchets out the spine, then puts. But we use a screw at L3. We distract between. While we distract, we reduce the kyphosis, the pelvic kyphosis, down to the S1. So I do not know how Arvind is going to put that rod from out of the skin into the L3 minimally invasive. So that's a final thing. So these are the steps which we use in a high dysplastic spine where we have to do a dome excision. So we do a dome excision and then, yes. So that's we have a four-year follow-up on this girl. That's a final result. Okay, and we have performed 11 surgeries after that paper in 2018. 5 of them have been in a live surgery workshop. I think we did one in Sanchari too, Silesh may remember. Only one of these patients now, out of the 11, we had to actually extend the fusion to L4, L5. Otherwise, we have done a monosegmental L5, S1. And these are all grade 4 or 5s. So, I want to learn, Arvind. How will you insert screws? How will you distract? How will you create space? How will you decompress before reduction? All this doing your minimally invasive. Thank you.
Great show. Very well presented, Appaji, on very challenging and tough topic. You are the superstar of Chennai Super Kings. And, you know, we are just waiting for seeing the Mumbai Indians superstar Arvind to defend. And then we will have discussions on this topic. Over to you, Arvind. Yeah, you are muted, Arvind. No, you are still muted.
How about now?
Yeah.
Appaji has muted me, you know. No, nothing can beat the experience of, you know, Sajan Hegde and Appaji's team. My experience with the high-grade listings is modest. And as you see in this presentation, it evolved from a certain grade to a certain grade. And at the end, I was surprised with my own results. So without, but I would like to say that, you know, I'd like to tickle Appaji. He's still in the nostalgic era of Karunanidhi and Jayalalitha. You know, it's all passe now. We have moved over to Stalin. So MISS is the call of the day. So
I'll start. Slideshow, that's what Guru is. Yeah.
Okay. So did you see the video? No.
Yes, sir, we saw it.
So basically, they go to hospital for open spine surgery, one of the few, even that cliff. So everyone is looking for minimal access now. So there are some challenges with this kind of situation where reduction is a problem, fusion is a problem. You need to get a good end plate contact to achieve fusion. And there's a lot of stress, shear stress. So achieving fusion in such a situation is difficult unless you get good reduction. And all this helps in getting your balance right. So this is how we started. So you can say it's about grade 2 lytic listhesis, almost reduced completely. So the trick is basically you release the disc. Actually, once you position the patient, you get some degree of reduction. And then once you open up the disc space from one side using the tube, you'll get a further, you know, flexibility, loosening of the disc space. Then you use your screws on the opposite side, distract it, and then put the cage from the opposite side and compress it. So that's how we achieve reduction. Another case, maybe two and a half grade listhesis. Again, which was done using MIS. So the strategies that we use when you treat these high-grade listhesis is these few. So one is positioning. So you position such a patient that, you know, you get some degree of reduction. It may be some degree of pelvic extension, etc. So try to get reduction. So this is common to both techniques, whether it is done with open or MIS. The most important part, so whenever you're correcting a deformity in spine, it is a function of the pedicle screw. So if you have a good, strong fixation, you know, you can manipulate and, you know, even treat a 150 degree scoliosis curve without doing an anterior release. So the pedicle screw fix, you know, hold or anchorage is very, very important when you achieve reduction in spinal deformity surgery. So it is everyone's dream to have a longest screw, a widest screw, and the most medial trajectory, especially when it comes to S5 and S1. And S1 especially, you need to get a good hold in the tricortical area because that area has three cortices and the shell of cortex around that area is absolutely strong because there's a lot of sclerosis there. So if you get a good purchase and get a bite in this corner here, you have won the match. So this is best with MIS because you can pick and choose your entry point to suit your best trajectory. And as Mihir said initially, navigation, robotics comes as an advancement along with MIS because MIS itself is an advancement. So when you pick and choose the entry points of this particular scar, so it's a blessing in disguise, MIS, in getting your screws right in the right direction. And since you use navigation and Appaji has a system wherein they use robotics, you can put the widest screw. So once we started using navigation, we could put 7.5 diameter screw in most of these patients. And you can also be so precise that you can get a bite in the distal cortex, you know, without making sure that you're not gone anterior to the cortex. So that is the beauty of minimal access with navigation. And again, dome osteotomy can be done using both the techniques, whether it is open or through the tube. So we always keep bombarded by this phrase called wide release by, you know, people who do spondylolytic listless surgery. So first of all, I don't understand what this wide release is, because these facet joints are not the spondylolytic listhesis, the movement occurs at the level of the isthmus. That particular facet joint at L5 S1, it's a wasted facet joint. So it is never moved throughout its life because there is no movement between L5 S1 at the level of the facet joint. So this wide release, I really want to know what this wide release is. And as you see, the dimension of the canal is wide. If you see the, you know, this is not in the plane, this axial is not in the plane of the L5 S1, the canal is extremely wide. So that I don't understand why you need to do a wide release. And even if you want to do a wide release, it's not quite simple with, you know, by docking the tube on both sides. So again, see, if you, when you're doing a open spine surgery, and if you want to get a good medial purchase, you need to strip, you know, right from, if Chennai is the center, right from Australia to Dubai, you need to strip to get your exposure right in the east-west direction. And here you'll have to strip right from Bombay to Colombo if you are, you know, operating on Chennai here. So that is the amount of exposure you need to get your trajectories right. So that can be done with small keyholes right on Chennai. So you don't need to expose. So beware of strippers. And again, look at this patient. Again, probably a grade 2.5 listhesis. This was one of our initial cases. You can hardly see this, you know, the scar. And most importantly, see this midline cleavage, when you compare MIS versus open, is very well maintained. And that gives a lot of cosmesis to the ladies who especially, are affected by this particular condition. So the steps are simple. You release the disc through the tube, put screws on the opposite side, distract, put cage on that particular side where you put your tube in, and then compress it and put screws on the opposite side and compress. So that it's as simple as that. So this is about grade 3 listhesis, which was done using the similar mechanism, another grade 3 listhesis. So this was in the learning curve, and this is almost, look at the degree of lumbosacral kyphosis here, and almost reduced completely with MIS. Look at these scars. So one of the intrinsic part of MIS relief is the whole surgery is image guided, and these patients, there is a lot of dysplasia occurring here, and navigation, etc., helps in putting the right screw in the right place without endangering the exiting or the traversing route. So in fact, our paper on high grade listhesis was appreciated by Professor Mazel, who had come for ASICON Goa. So he actually, it was a matter of pride that he borrowed our slides for his presentation somewhere. So this is a case which was done prior to lockdown about 2 years back. So this patient, I was surprised by our own ability to handle this patient with MIS. So that gives me confidence to talk today. So this is a 48 years old lady with a high BMI, short and stout lady, who had back pain of 15 years duration with significant, she came with significant right-sided L5 dermatomal pain, which is claudicant in nature. You can see there it's a high grade spondyloptosis. So these are the dynamic X-rays, doesn't reveal any movement at all. So, the slip angle is 60 degrees. That denotes the lumbosacral kyphosis. And this is the lumbar lordosis, 100 degrees. It should be ideally about 50 to 60 degrees. So this is her MRI. So the patient was very, very clear about her options. She wanted a MIS surgery, and I was wondering if I'm crazy. So I sent her back 3 times and denied the possibility to the referring physician, who also thought that I could do it. So what was going on in my mind? Is she crazy? Am I getting crazy to be convinced by her? Is she challenging me? In case I try to be a hero, what if she develops a deadly complications? You know, if she gets bilateral foot drop, what to do? So the plan was to take a middle path, an easy way out. So do abduce procedure, which is called a delta fixation. So transvertebral screw from S1 L1 to L5, then go extend till L4 into a postulateral fusion. So this is possible using MIS. It's very simple. So that was my plan. And once I positioned the patient, my plan changed. I saw some degree of vacuum here and got some confidence. So this is a video. So this is where I've gone from the right side. And you can see my tube is in the foramen on the right side. This is the exiting route, that L5 route. So this, my pen field is on the L5 body posteriorly. And I did a dome osteotomy. So this is, the L5 is somewhere down here. And this is the S1 superior end plate. So I did a dome osteotomy with this osteotome. So the guide wires were already in L5 and S1. So navigation helped us to check where we are. So this was the calcified annulus, etc. Which is all excised. So we packed a lot of bone graft in the front. So that is the exiting route. So once the dome osteotomy was done, as we hammered the cage, we saw that the L5 vertebral body was lifted up. And I could see the L5 root getting relaxed. So, and then with the compression across the screws, we got an excellent correction of the lumbosacral kyphosis. So these were the steps. So we saw that, you know, the cage just lifted the L5 body up, and this is how we got a reduction. It's about grade 1.5 now, possibly. But you can see that, you know, we got a good balance. So the good improvement in the lumbosacral angle and the lumbar lordosis, which we published again in a review article. So there are some publications, but none of these publications show any case with lumbosacral kyphosis. They were all patients with translation, not much of kyphosis. So it is possible and better with minimal access. The advantage is to the surgeon that it is less stressful and more elegant. Benefits to the patient is minimal trauma, better cosmesis, early recovery, again, elegance. Of course, for beginners, there is a learning curve to it. And before you get into this rut of doing difficult cases, you should have experience with easy cases, straightforward cases. Thank you.
Yes, Appaji.
Arvind, nice presentation. As I said, if Arvind has to send back a patient 3 times, he's been doing MIS for last 12, 13 years now. Imagine guys like me, who are like inexperienced fellows. Where do I go to do an MIS?
No, not just me. Even Mihir and Vishal Peshatiwar, they were good series of difficult listases. Maybe more in number than me. It is reproducible.
I understand. We are starting at 2005 now. Yes.
I think Appaji has shown excellent work, and he is still saying old is gold. We can really do a very good reduction in high grades. And the technology, what Arvind is talking about, technology does not make a bad surgeon good, but it makes a good surgeon better. So I would like to know the views of Mihir first.
I think going over from Appaji to Arvind, I think percutaneous screws have really, really changed.
the way we have started looking at minimally invasive listhesis reductions, the trajectories are excellent. The purchase of these pedicles is excellent. You hardly miss them. And the thing is that you don't have to dissect anything. So you are really minimally invasive starting from your screws. So that is the winning point of this procedure. And you can actually end up doing a microscopic discectomy. Like Arvind says, what do you mean by lateral release? When we open up and jack up the disc, the lysis defect opens up. And all you've got to do is trace your exiting route out, which is very easy even through a microdiscectomy approach. You don't need to sort of go ahead and dissect everything outright, because that we have probably now accepted is not required.
Yeah, I would like to ask Arvind, when you are doing this, whether you need in grade 3 or 4, whether you need to do bilateral release, bilateral facet release, or you can just come get away with only unilateral?
See, I've never done a bilateral release. I mean, this spondyloptosis is the only one case, but even those grade 3, etc., I've never done a bilateral release. See, most of them, I tell you, once you position them, you'll get good amount of reduction. And you can see that actually, if the disc, even Appaji's case, so you can see the enormous increase the disc height once it was reduced. You know, so that means the foramen is also open. It's not that just that parallels with the foraminal size. So it's really not necessary to, you know, waste your time trying to trace out the roots.
Yeah, mind it for all the colleagues and viewers. These are the really challenging scenarios, and it's open or MIS. The technique is important. How you handle the nerve roots is also equally important, because there are series of patients which were done in the past, and we are still seeing that while reduction, there are chances of neurodeficit. So these are not that easy cases. And yes, Mihir, you're saying.
No, I think if you really look at it, at the ends of the spine, there has been a paradigm shift in the concept. AAD is a realignment procedure. A listhesis is also a realignment procedure. It is not a decompression procedure. The once you realign and distract, your neural roots on both sides in a lytic listhesis are free. So it doesn't, you don't have to go down and see each and every exiting route. You just have to get a proper alignment. That's the whole concept here now. And I think it works fabulously well. I had my own doubts, but somehow it works extremely well.
Yeah, correct. You said it right, Miran. I was talking to one of the surgeons, and he was saying, I went to Twin Cities and we saw that they were doing reductions, and we came back and we did bilateral reduction and put cage, and the patient got up with bilateral foot drop. Means it's not, it's all balancing. You know, it is not one thing in this. It is putting the screws well, decompression well, distraction well. Everything has to go very gently, very carefully, and the anterior release well.
Yeah, so to,
Guru Raj,
to answer your question, yes. When do you need to go bilateral? Now, really, if your screws are not purchasing well, or if the listhesis is so stiff that you really cannot pull it back and reduce it to grade 1, grade 2, and jack up the disc height really yes. well, then you need to do a neurolysis, because you need to create a channel for the root. So that's one scenario which will probably require a bilateral. Otherwise, it doesn't require a bilateral.
Now, there are few surgeons who speak about bilateral release in high grade for MIS. Open, yes, open is okay. But for MIS, it is very easy when you do bilateral release. The distraction becomes easy. The anterior release becomes easy. And you can go on the cage to reduce it in a very high grade 4 or 5. Yes, Guru Raj.
I had two questions to Arvind. The case which you showed, Arvind, you just did a dome osteotomy from right side. So yeah. how is that possible to take away the whole dome from only one side?
No, you're angling. See, that was just one part of the osteotomy you saw. I moved the osteotomy in various directions.
But then you say that you are able to take a dome from the left, also from the right?
It's a dome. It's right in the center. It's not encompassing one end to the other. So you're hammering down. So since it is all an image-guided surgery with your probe, you can see where till where you're reached, you know.
So that is why you say that for such kind of surgeries, then navigation is very important with intraoperative imaging.
It helps. Yeah.
Yeah. And the second
thing. Add a point.
Second question is, how many patients of yours had a post-operative neurological deficits or worsening?
Not a single one.
None?
See, in this patient also, this is the first case done with MIS, the TLIF, for spondyloptosis. My plan was to go on the opposite side if I was not getting a good reduction. So once it started moving, I stopped there, and the cage was right in the center. It was not on one side. So I'd already spent about 3.5 hours. So I was happy with what I got. So I closed there. If not, my next step was to go on the opposite side. Maybe if I do a 5 or 6, I'll have better understanding of how things work.
And neuromonitoring, Arvind?
No, as I said, I was going to do a delta fixation here.
So you are not using neuromonitoring?
I was not using.
Actually, crazy, yes, then.
Guru Raj, you recommend neuromonitoring.
So I think I did a shortening procedure by doing a Dohm osteotomy.
So because, see, our high-grade listhesis, we have had like 2-3 cases. As soon as we used to reduce, signals will disappear. You leave it, signals will come back. And you manipulate a bit, the signals will disappear and when you monitor EMGs. So I think for high-grade listhesis, again, I think at least in our experience, I do recommend that we should use a neuromonitoring. Okay.
Yes, Appaji.
Dohm osteotomy, it is like a shortening procedure. You know, like you do a closure of kyphotic deformity. Probably it relaxes. So once we did that, we could see the stretch in the L5 root coming down, you know.
Yes, Appaji.
About the neurodeficit, yes. Mihir, you hit the correct point. Actually, decompression does not matter. Previously, we used to talk about wide decompression for all cases before you attempt reduction. The positioning matters, actually. If you flex the hip, you are actually extending, you are lengthening the L5 root. By extending the hip and slightly flexing the knee, you reduce the transgression distance for the L5 root. And once you attempt reduction, you don't have to do decompression. And once you get the foramen, you are okay. You would have seen in the recent times in the demo surgeries or in our videos, we don't do the decompression first. We attempt the reduction, we reduce fully, and then go in to do a TLIF on one side. We don't even attempt the decompression on the other side. Second point about Guru's neuromonitoring, we have not used neuromonitoring for high-grade spondy for two reasons. One is neuromonitoring is useless if you are doing a root surgery. Unless otherwise you have a bipolar root stimulation, which is possible. Neuromonitoring is almost useless in a root surgery.
I would totally disagree, Appaji. Neuromonitoring is possible in root surgeries. You can monitor continuous EMGs, and you can actually, we do have a root stimulator, but then you can monitor your continuous EMGs. You will get a real-time monitoring when you monitor roots to try to reduce, you will see that nerve root irritations happening. So you see those concussions happening in those signals. So I see that neuromonitoring for root surgery.
Point well taken, Guru Raj.
I just want to check, do these palsies recover? Dr. Acharya, Mir?
No, I've been very lucky with MIS. I have probably never had a neurological deficit. But the old cases, see, it's an L5 root injury. And we know that L5 roots are anyway notorious. They don't recover really completely. If at all you want to convince yourself that it has recovered from grade 3 to grade 3 plus, you are happy with it. So it's like convincing yourself.
Yeah, in our paper also, 3 patients, 1 had a permanent deficit, 2 had partial deficit to start with. So they improved a little bit, but they were functionally useful recoveries. But 1 had a complete foot drop and she continued to have a foot.
No, but one thing which I would like to add now, I do not know whether this is correct or wrong, but when I was widely decompressing, in fact, you end up handling the root more.
you know, you end up really going aggressively and trying to free that root far laterally. I don't know whether that makes the root a little more friable or vulnerable to injury. And then you stretch that root, which is already edematous. Ever since we started skipping those steps, it's actually paying well.
Neurological worsening.
Actually, the positioning mattered. That's what my finding. First 13 patients, we used to position a lazy flexed hip. Then I had a discussion with Dr. Jean Dubousset and Leong himself, who did a close reduction, and they used to do close reduction and casting for high-grade spondies. So it was his suggestion that why don't you position, because this paper when I was presenting, Professor Jean Dubousset was there. So he told me, why don't you try this? So we started doing that and we never had a deficit after positioning the patient with a hip extension.
Yeah, so I think bringing out that L5 into a little lesser kyphosis is actually the most important factor where you avoid a root injury. It simplifies the whole procedure. That means it just reduces the stress on everything.
It shortens the root.
Yeah,
I think a lot of learning points important is positioning, extension of the hips. Yeah, additional screw at L3 and distraction, MIS way with the technology advancement. I would like to take final comments from Shankar sir, and then we move on to our last topic of the day.
Well, I think when heroes are speaking, I should keep quiet. I am an open surgeon.
Rather, Shankar, when the jokers stop, the real hero arrives.
No, that's not true. But I think there is a lot of learning point. And I think the important learning point, as Appaji said, is positioning. And that has made a difference in our practice also. Though I am an open surgeon, but there are a few things I have learned from everybody over the years that I do not now decompress completely, as Arvind said. So I keep the midline, because these high-grade spondylolisthic cases, the midline, you can easily get a dural tear or a rupture because they are so thin and they have spina bifida and all sorts of things. So, and there is definitely true. If you're trying to put in an open screw, you have to go far lateral. The muscle is always coming in the way. The open pedicle screw is much more difficult than a navigated or a percutaneous pedicle screw. There's no doubt. But obviously, you have to get it right. Whenever I'm worried, the only advice I can see is that say that this L5 pedicles are fairly sclerotic. And sometimes they are so sclerotic and small that you have to be careful even when you are doing your minimal invasive. So sometimes I feel the medial border, I would make a small drill and then I put in a percutaneous screw. So even if I am doing an open, I put a guide wire and then thread the screw over it. Otherwise, I can break the pedicle. And so these are the tips that I use, which is helpful in high-grade listhesis. So even if you're doing an open, you can go lateral to the muscle and put your percutaneous through your jamshidi needle and then see the medial wall, and gradually, then you don't make mistakes. So getting the screw right is very, very important. Getting the position right is very, very important. I feel the loosening of the disc helps. And so I take some time in loosening the disc before I put in my cage. And I learned from Appaji that you can... use that cage distractor by using a higher distractor and then putting the screw and putting the rod on the other side while you hyperextend the hip, and then you take out this and then put bone graft. That should work. So as Mihir rightly said, getting that kyphosis corrected, getting your reduction done and putting your screws in correctly, and then of course Arvind Kulkarni's tricks I also want to learn. Who doesn't want to be Arvind Kulkarni? Getting everything done through a tube. But you should be safe. So don't try to put in the tube and then take off the nerve root and then curse Arvind Kulkarni, because he has gone through this for 15 years. So if you want to do that, get the positioning right, get your percutaneous screws, get your navigation, get your systems in place, and then slowly build up the way. So you must go from class 1 to class 10. Don't jump, because young people get so impressed with Mihir and Arvind and Appaji that they may jump into it straight and then land into trouble, because we don't want a procedure to be discredited, because these are surgeons who have really learned the rope and the hard way and the correct way. So that is important.
Thank you. Our academic chair has said it nailed it very right. And we will go on to the last topic to clear out the confusion and the evidence from Dr. Himanshu Kulkarni. Over to you, Himanshu.
Thank you, sir. After Dr. Acharya sir's remarks, I don't think there is any confusion left. But so this is the last point. My job is, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. So this is the last point. My job is really difficult. We have had two extremely well-planned and very well thought out debates between four of our great surgeons, which we all young guys look up to. So first was, this one was actually about MIS or open fusion. And second was whether to decompress or whether to fuse primarily for a large disc. So after these two exciting matchups, my job is really boring. So after a great match, my job is of a guy who is doing analysis at the end of the match. It's a boring thing.
Pradyuman was looking like Rafa.
Huh?
Pradyuman was looking like Rafa, Nadal.
Yes, sir.
That is Federer.
My job is like a boring analysis guy who has to come after a match, do the analysis and bore everybody. But that is the part of the game. Every great match is always followed with an analysis. So I'm going to keep it short. And I'll start with first debate. It was a Shakespearean debate to fuse or not to fuse. So when it comes to fusion, there have been a lot of papers. This is a paper by Sato et al. They have described that the lumbar disc herniation which is massive or one with a segmental instability, it can be well treated with a PLIF. It's an old paper, 2006. So it is about PLIF. Now all of us have moved on to TLIFs. So they have said if it's a large disc, if it's a large herniated disc, you can go for a primary fusion. Another paper, it is about adolescent to young patients with large protruded lumbar interbody fusion surgery. It has got good surgical outcome with few complications. That's what they have said. It's a large study with 222 patients. That's what they have published in 2013. So it is about fusion. Do you want to decompress? Yes, there is the evidence about only decompression also, obviously. So now the types of decompressions, the literature had changed over the years, whether you want to open it, you want to do it MIS, whether you want to do it through endoscopy. The type of decompression actually is not the part of debate. It is whether to decompress or not to decompress. So this is a paper which talks about, it is by Kanu et al, which talks about minimally invasive discectomy, that is through tubes and MIS. So MIS discectomy after a large lumbar disc herniation had showed excellent clinical outcome. The clinical evidence supporting the superiority of MAD, PED over open surgery is still limited. All give excellent outcome after discectomy. So there has been a lot of debate in literature, a lot of debate everywhere, which is the best method. So the jury is still out. Probably the time will come and the time will tell. Another evidence about decompression, it is Mohammad Hussain et al. Who had presented the paper in 2014. The sample size was 285. A large uncontained lower lumbar disc herniation can be sufficiently removed using MAD, which is an effective alternate to open discectomy procedures with remarkable long-term outcome. They had a follow-up of 8 years for these patients. Remarkable long-term outcome functions, maximum benefit can be gained if we adhere to 6 selection criteria. So they also have put a asterisk there that you have to select the patient very carefully, which is a permanent asterisk probably. We have spoken about two individual procedures. Now comparison, a percutaneous endoscopy or MIS fusion. So this is the latest trend. So here the sample size was 360. So percutaneous lumbar endoscopic discectomy and MIS TLIF both have showed favorable clinical outcomes, but had different sets of complications when these modalities were used for massive lumbar disc herniations. Obviously, as expected, therefore, the main difference between these two treatments was related to post-operative complications, which were most common complication was adjacent segment degeneration in fusion and recurrence rate in endoscopic discectomy alone, and not the functional outcome. So they say that the functional outcome is going to be similar where either you fuse or decompress when it comes to long-term results. The only difference is going to be the complications related to each procedure. Another paper, it is from India itself. It was published in Global Spine Journal. Comparison of functional outcomes between lumbar interbody fusion and discectomy in a massive lumbar disc herniation. It is from Dr. Guru Raj's Institute. Both show good functional outcome in long term. recurrent herniation and instability, it is more with discectomy, and adjacent segment degeneration is more common with fusion surgeries. The choice of the procedure has to be individualized and it has to depend on your own surgical experience. So these were six papers. We had to actually, the papers are very much, we had to select very specific and to the point papers. So this was about whether to fuse or not to fuse. So the literature says you can fuse if you're good with it, you can decompress if you're good with it, but you have to choose your patient very wisely and you have to choose your disc type and the instability very wisely. Second debate, whether you should open it or you should do it MIS. So if you have to do it MIS, this was the paper which was shown by Dr. Arvind sir also. It was a paper about a reduction technique when it is to be done through MIS. So MIS TLIF for reduction, it was grade 2 or higher actually with a rocking technique. So what they say is MIS TLIF for reduction using this rocking technique, it is extremely effective. You can achieve complete reduction of the slippage, excellent correction with overall sagittal profile, and it can be achieved. No need of involvement of healthy adjacent segment if you're able to reduce it with this technique. So you don't have to go to L4. You can very nicely fuse it to two affected levels. Another to the point conclusion of this paper by Chang et al. It was like what they had to say was reduction of high grade lumbosacral spondylolisthesis can be very easily achieved by minimally invasive TLIF, and it gives you excellent outcome. Another paper supporting MIS, Qureshi et al. It was published in European Spine Journal in 2013. MIS, they have termed it as minimal access, that is MIS or MAS. MAS fusion is feasible, safe, and clinically effective with the added benefit of reduced soft tissue disruption. Our result of the technique suggests that the ability to correct the focal deformity and to achieve the excellent radiographic and clinical outcome is that similar to an open procedure. So probably they had a large series of 120 patients. So if you do it through experience and if you do it properly, it is going to be similar to open procedure. This is the paper that we all of India has fallen in love with. The paper with just Dr. Appaji sir just mentioned with him in that paper. It is a paper about long-term experience with reduction technique in the high-grade spondylolisthesis. So they also have stated when it comes to open surgery, their experience is excellent, as Dr. Appaji sir has already stated. The reduction technique and fusion proved technique for the fusion proved effective in managing high-grade spondylolisthesis when assessed by radiographic and functional measures. Though surgically demanding, the technique is safe and reproducible, and the long-term outcomes are very satisfying. So this paper has been very thoroughly discussed already. Another proponent of open technique, a multicenter evaluation. This was published in 2017. So they say the present study suggests that reduction when accomplished in a conjunction with wide open neural element decompression and instrumented arthrodesis is safe, effective, and durable with lower rates of neurological injury with clinical favorable results and high fusion rates. So this is they have done all the cases through open technique. So there is no paper which actually compares. There are very few papers which have been speaking about MIS technique because it is probably an up and coming technique. No comparison. I could show you some papers of comparison to the previous debate, but there is no really comparison which is being carried. Probably some papers are in process, but in literature, there is no comparison when it comes to MIS or open for high grade spondylolisthesis. So another paper the last paper for open technique is reduction and fusion for high-grade 5S1 spondylolisthesis, Moreau et al. This was published in 2016. Surgery on a single posterior open approach gives reliable results in high-grade spondylolisthesis in adolescents and young adults. Reduction on the listhesis is not devoid of complications, and thorough decompression of exiting roots needs to be done to avoid deficit before reduction. So this is what they feel. So they have specifically mentioned about the reduction. So what is the inference of all this? We had 2 hours of debate, excellent debates for a guy of generation of me. It was an excellent debate to clear some thoughts. So what do we say about this? So all these methods are tried and tested. All these methods are excellent in the hands of the masters from whom we have learned. So if you have to do MIS, it looks very good in the hands of Dr. Arvind Kulkarni. If you want to reduce a high-grade spondylolisthesis, it looks excellent when Dr. Appaji sir does it. So is MIS good? Yes, there is a literature supporting to that. Is open surgery good? Yes, it's an old gold standard. The literature supports that. Do you want to do fusion for selected cases? Yes, it's a winner. You have to do fusion when it is indicated. Are you going to do complete decompression? You can do that. So all these are tried and tested methods with good, reliable outcomes. These are the masters who have been doing well. And obviously, the results are going to look very handsome in their hands. So what do we do? So you have to do what is best for you. You have to choose your patient wisely. This is a message for all those guys. So you have to choose your patient very wisely. All of the surgeons who have been here have very specifically mentioned that. So you have to choose your patient wisely. And you have to do what is best in your hands. So you have to, the patient comes first. You have to give the optimum result to your patient. So you have to choose the patient wisely. You have to counsel the patient wisely. And you have to do what is best in your hands. So that is probably what it sums up. Probably Bapat sir has something to say about it.
Yeah, Himanshu, you can collect all the big trophies from all the speakers. You can keep them to yourself. Distribute the smaller one to all the four. Because I'm sure I am the winner.
Yes, sir.
As confusing because, as ever.
Because the platform was laid so nicely by you. Everything adds on that.
Absolutely. I wanted to tell the same. I think Mihir is more confused than before now.
So, like I said, the degenerative disorders are like eternal teachers. We are all backbenchers. We never learn.
Yeah. I think excellent summation, Himanshu, and very good evidence and data which you have shown. And we're really impressed with the way you presented. It was a class apart presentation, Himanshu. And what you said, that was very important. What I can do is more important than what I should do. You know, okay, what you can reproduce a good result is more important than trying something. So it is all these people have mastered these techniques and they are doing it. So therefore, it's very, very important to understand our own limitations in our own setups and what we are really trained to do it. That's all I want to say. And I would like to hear from the bosses.
I think, thank you, Sailesh, for organizing this excellent show of stalwarts presenting their views. I think you can get convinced by all of them. So I think they all did very well in their own ways of thought process and beliefs. But when you have their racket, you have to be very careful. You can't do Arvind Kundakarni or Mihir Bapat or Appaji, because when you have the racket, the patient will come back to you. So it is very important. So I think it was very good, very learning, and I learned quite a few things. Thank you very much. And thanks everyone for...
Thank you guys.
...involved and got getting emotional in the initial stage, actually. Thank you, Sailesh. Thank you, Appaji. Good night.
So, bye, Appaji. Bye, Shankar.
Stay safe, everyone.
Yeah.
Good night,
bye, sir. Bye. Bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye, Arvind.
Thank you all.
Bye, Guru.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, Pune Orthopedic Society, Ortho TV, and Sanjati Hospital for this wonderful webinar today. Thank you all.